Welcome to Two Trade Asia's Midyear Outlook and Review. Our agenda is to highlight where we are now, which way next, and our sector calls. Philippine equities swayed with the global COVID-19 pandemic and breached its lowest at 4,000. With a gradual relaxation of enhanced community quarantine or ECQ, the market regained its poise and recovered 51% from this mark, but still 21% lower for 2020. Among the index basket, 25 listed shares were hammered by supply pressure with declines ranging from 35% to 47%, notable of which were Security Bank, GT Cap, and Metro Bank. On the other hand, there were a number that rose led by telco staples PLDT and Globe, retailer Pure Gold, all benefiting from high data demand and grocery needs from the ECQ and holding firm Metro Pacific Investments. From first quarter's 0.2% economic contraction, second quarter will reflect the full impact of the ECQ, bringing second quarter GDP at negative 13.2%. Consumption is seen to fall by 6.2% for this quarter, given the closure of malls and retail establishments. With gradual business resumption in the coming quarters, however, slight recovery is seen, but lagged effects would still be present with the addition of 12 million unemployed people, majority of which are in construction, tourism, transport, and accommodation sectors. Note that unemployment for January this year was at 5% and swung to 17% in April, equivalent to about 7 million people. Third quarter this year would also be marked by the rainy season, which is bound to affect infra works completion. Overall, if GCQ continues until year end, GDP for 2020 could contract to 7.9%. For 2021, there are two scenarios considered. First, economic growth might resume to 3.7%, assuming full lifting of quarantine measures, gradual normalcy in logistics, and reabsorption of displaced workforce. On the other hand, contraction might prevail with GDP at negative 5.9% if hybrid GCQ measures would still be in place in the absence of COVID-19 vaccine. Note also that if localized lockdowns continue even on GCQ status, the country's labor force situation could worsen and lead to additional 1 million new unemployment per month. Between these two scenarios, we are hopeful that recovery would soon ensue as global governments fast-track their economy's normalcy, including development of a vaccine. Despite the uncertainties, the common question in mind is whether members in the index basket are resilient enough to weather COVID-19 challenges. And yes, these market pillars have enough financial strength to weather the rout. From a PSEI median gauge, here are the list of companies that are cash rich, most liquid, and solvent. Better yet, we took on select index stocks endurance tests by measuring the possibility of default using Altman Z-score. This covers working capital cover, their retained earnings, asset turnover, and capital structure. From the chart, the ones at the safe zone or green box are those with high scores. Red box for weak scoring. Simply put, swings in the index or the green line have preceded economic cycles. This suggests funds positioning whenever GDP recovery is ascertained. Looking at the blue line for GDP from second quarter of 2007 until fourth quarter of 2008, market sentiment swayed to weak GDP numbers. Note, however, that when an inflection point was achieved, the market was quick to bounce from its lows. This only shows that history supports the call, position in anticipation, not in reaction. Even within the region, similar scenarios occurred for the US and Hong Kong markets, where gauges quickly recovered upon announcement of weak economic news. In essence, we think 2020 will be range-bound within 5,400 to 6,600. But for 2021, we firmly believe that negative news have been priced in. 7,400 is likely to be the target premised on First, recovery of labor market. Next is return of consumer confidence and mobility. Third, the impact of reforms and stimulus packages. Fourth, comeback of all modes of transport. And last, reboot of local tourism. Which sectors then for 2021? Banks, logistics, infra, and construction top our overweight sector category. Wild cards are on power, property, mining and oil, and underweight for food and beverage, downstream oil, and gaming.
Thanks to capital raising exercises and prudent risk management, listed Philippine banks can survive potential losses in case non-performing loans rise. Capital buffers are in fact higher than minimum, with prospective loan loss coverage highest for Metro Bank, China Bank, and Security Bank. 2021 would be a recovery play for key banks, with earnings per share seen rising between 30% to 52%. Price-to-book value discounts range 35% to 59%, save for Security Bank. Relative to our forecasted target price, investing in banks is rewarding for long-term investors, with upside angles at 15% to even 98%.
Another sector to consider covers logistics, as the need for mobility took on a stronger name during community quarantine. Visits in e-commerce sites surged from 44% to as high as 94% during the height of ECQ, reinforcing several enterprises' move towards e-commerce platforms. Given this, we see windfall cascading towards vertical integration, specifically for warehousing needs and delivery services. In fact, warehousing will be underscored as migration increases from Mega Manila to key provincial megacities. This will be amplified by the government's Balik Probinsya program, where infra support will also rise as proximity to residential or workplace communities is addressed. In fact, several conglomerates have integrated logistics to their business portfolios, realizing long-term advantages in distribution synergies. Another sector to watch out for is infra construction, given aggressive public spending for infrastructure in the coming years. We expect the private sector to absorb a chunk of this, given the size and urgency to implement these projects. That won't be a problem in this low interest rate environment. Cost of capital is comfortable enough that infra firms have the leeway to venture in more projects that seemed tight before. The sophistication of the local REIT market will also encourage fundraising via infra REITs.
Moving on to our wildcards, medium-term drivers for power are starting to show strength, specifically for improving demand. Moreover, rolling average prices at the wholesale electricity spot market, or WESM, is recovering but still lower versus full 2019's average. From a broader perspective, upside to this sector will be on green energy, with expected 20,000 megawatts in renewable energy by 2040. Government support will be the key to achieving this power mix. Currently, players in this space include AC Energy PH, FGen, and Aboitiz Power. We are also looking at the mining sector as a wildcard. The fact remains that the Philippines is well mineralized, given the need to fund big state projects such as the Universal Healthcare Bill, regulations can be eased to access additional public revenues from mining. Speaking of regulations, for this sector to truly shine, there must be some loosening in policy, both in permitting and taxation. Doing so will not only encourage participation in mining, but also curtail small-scale and illegal mining activities.
Finally, we turn to property. Here you can see an outline of drivers and resistances that we expect over the next few quarters. We stand with our previous notion that office and industrial will remain at least steady given BPO resurgence for office and e-commerce boom for industrial. On the other end, the residential segment is most disrupted due to weak OFW receipts, lower spending for real estate, among others. We maintain, however, that fundamentals in this space, which include expected rise in home ownership of both millennials and the Gen Z, will anchor recovery in the long term. That said, there's no reason to outright dismiss property firms which comprise a chunk of the index, especially those who have high recurring income mix. Not only will they be able to weather out lower demand for residential, but also obtain funding access via REITs. Moving on to our underweight sectors, gaming will remain tied with the erosion in both local and foreign-derived gross gaming receipts, or GGR, due to mobility and spending changes brought about by the pandemic. Food and beverage is another. Despite staple goods enjoying decent demand, this is still offset by restricted food traffic for restaurants and reduced budget for discretionary items. Finally, we are cautious on downstream oil, with aviation taking a hit from social distancing protocols. Also, sharp reduction in refining margins is seen, although inventory losses may have peaked during the oil crash in the first quarter.
Onto the exciting section. Our stock picks for 2020, which underscore hopes 2021 will be a better year. First up, Metrobank. A big reason for which is that its valuation of 0.44 times book value is unwarranted, given its size and even with expected high loan loss absorption. Our target is at 58.30 pesos per share. Our next bank is East West. We think the market has yet to notice its 0.32 times book value and favorable net interest margins. Among logistics, Ayala Land Logistics is another pick with target at 2.96 pesos per share. We envision OLHC to proxy logistics growth in the provinces, especially for industrial parks' warehousing needs.
Next is Eagle, with target at 13.85 pesos per share. This stock should benefit from captive demand for infra projects in Luzon, such as the Bulacan Airport project. Finally, Metro Pacific Investments, which we believe to be one of the most defensive value plays. Valuations could improve as management redirects its sale towards less regulated industries.
In finality, the main theme is to ride the volatility. While challenges are ahead, positioning should be made in anticipation, not in reaction. Borrowing an old saying, the strength of a ship is not gauged when it's in harbor and moored. The greatest of ships are the ones at sea, survive the best waves, and past turbulent storms. Thank you, and keep safe.